Hello, everyone, to the second installment of Roulette Recap. Show where we, or podcast, I think it's originally meant to be a little bit, where we just talk about Roulette Rivals, the tournaments that are happening right now and everything surrounding it. I am joined today by the people that were on last time with me as well, GK Punk and Infrafun, and new guest, Janini. Welcome, everyone.
Hi.
you are allowed to
hello.
Say yeah. Hello.
Didn't want to go for it. If we all say at the same time hi, then it's there's no order, so that would have been weird. But yeah, hello, everyone. Glad to be here.
Glad to have every one of you here. Second episode. It's been, I think, 2 weeks since the last one. Lots of stuff has happened, most namely the RRWC 2021 group stage has passed, large portion of it. We're on the final week, just two more matches, the losers bracket, semifinals, and the grand finals happening on Sunday are missing. Now we're just gonna have a look back at the KO stage, what's happened there, take a look at the last remaining players in the tournament, and just maybe a little bit talk about the future and try ourselves at predicting and stuff like that. Trying to see what we... what we think will happen in the last two matches. And I guess without further ado, we can pretty much already jump into it and start to talk about the KO stage that has passed us.
I think so too. If that's my cue to start,
it is.
So obviously, we have gathered here to talk about the Roulette Rivals World Championship 2021, which is, well, I already forgot, but I think it's a 7 week plus a 3 day event, so basically 2 months. And we had a recap after the group stages, and now we can have a recap about most of the knockout stage. Of course, we have the final three, but only one finalist, and two hoping to make it there tomorrow. I think that's already announced.
It is
scheduled for tomorrow, 20 CET.
Yes, do not miss it.
Yeah, so basically 22 and a half hours from now. But I meant to talk about the past here. The last 3.5 weeks, basically, Well, both brackets, I will talk about the winner's bracket and then curry about the losers, or like maybe the main person talking about it. And so we rounded off the group stage in mid-November, and 32 players entered the winner's bracket, the top four of every group. Of course, we had 8 players in every group. A couple forfeits, of course, happened here and there, but mostly a fair fight, and everyone got their well deserved spot in the final 32. And were assigned to the bracket. It wasn't a second draw, it wasn't anything random, it was already predetermined who gets where, by the positions, by the way. Because every group winner was matched with a fourth place finisher from the opposite group. So if you won group A, then, which is the first group, then you play the fourth place finisher from the last group alphabetically, which is H. And just like that, the second place finishers played third place finishers. And also that the winner's bracket was also balanced by group letter, and by that I mean that every quarter of the bracket had one player from each of the 8 groups and exactly 2 winners. And so what I mean by that, I guess, is if the group stage was balanced and the top players rose to the top, and like you imagine first place being a favorite against fourth place, then you can like project the winners to the future rounds, and after the group stage, we had the eight group winners set up in a way that we expected or we projected the following group three matches. These aren't predictions, but it's how the group winners stacked up. So we had myself versus I Like It Man in the first column or the first quarter, K Canetta versus Chris X3 in the second quarter, and then we were projecting to see Ducker versus Danny Buta in the third one and Fraud7 versus Tinor23 in the last one. And I'm just saying this because this happened in two cases, these group winners meeting, but it completely fell apart in the other two quarters. So it just goes to show how unpredictable can this get. And Jesus, how much have I rambled without a single match, but I'm going to get it in now. Just a quick another word about the format. It was first to four for the first two rounds, which means that players banned one map each, then picked one map each. And if there was a need for a third map and beyond, they were random from the remaining map pool. There were no repeats allowed. No one could pick or ban the same map again until the grand final. And 47-minute timer is worth keeping an eye out on. And I don't think we had a single tie, so of course top 32 finished or played very well. And this first to four was up to first to six from round three and LB round three. I think I can now finally talk about the first quarter and make up the lost time already.
All good.
Nothing was chronologically here, and I will just go from top to bottom and first to last quarter. So we have some sort of order in here. And yeah, round one, first match, defending champion is already down in the loser's bracket. David Red Sox beat me 4-2. At least I got a New York World Record out of that, and David got two more maps and advanced to round two. He played Mr. Mike, who defeated some random person, which was a significant match because the second and third place finisher of RR1 played against each other. So two players with insane experience and Mike coming out on top. Then we had the other fourth place finishers upset, Crudy beating I Like Hitman 4-2. And sort of an upset, but maybe not really looking at the group stage performance, Pijero beating Johnny X in the Battle of the Dutchman 4-0. I'll just talk about the round two and three matches, and then I'll stop for you guys to chime in, of course. In round two, we had two Americans playing, and Mr. Mike got another sweep down, so that was two matches and no maps lost against David Red Sox. And Pijero came back from behind. I think it was a Haven struggle for him, but won maybe like Colorado and Chongqing to beat Crudy to make it to round three, which was the first to six match, and it went down to the wire, as you can see, 6-4 Pijero. It was a really memorable Miami spin to me, where there were like two remote kills, both Robert and Sierra, and both struggled with both of them, I think. There was a loud explosion, Sierra just, of course, flying where you can't grab her, and Robert electrocution, I think the guard kept finding him or something like that. So that was Pijero's photo finish, and then eventually the last map he won was a New York photo finish by 7 seconds. So that's how much Pijero won by. And that made it to round four, which was his best result to date. So yeah, it's first quarter, and Pijero advancing here, despite the first and third place finisher of last year's World Championship being here. What do you guys think of this quarter?
If I were, I'm going to chime in first here. It's definitely something that at least the three of us that were on here last time didn't really predict, because just as a reminder, at the end of last episode, InfraFront, GK Punk, and me predicted the who would play in the round three matches. And yeah, the only correct guesses were InfraFront predicting a Pidgeotto appearance in the round three, and me predicting Mr. Mike to be there. Everything else, we had two times David Red Sox guess instead of Mr. Mike, and 2 times Johnny X instead of Pidgeotto. Those did not turn out how we predicted them to, and maybe that just shows that, yeah, everything can just go either way, really. And yeah, did not turn out how we imagined it to.
I'm not sure either of you guys have a memorable moment or match or person from this part of the group.
I mean, to me, it was really impressive. Like, I rate Johnny very highly as a player. He's not the most consistent one, but I think he has a very high quality level. So I was quite impressed by Pujero's performance. I think he did really well in the whole tournament and really showed by his performance. But what stands out to me here is the round two match, Mr. Mike versus Pujero. You already said how close it was, but I really want to highlight, like, what an incredible watch that match was. Yeah, sure, the Miami Spin, they struggled with that a lot, and it was entertaining to watch, and it was still a photo finish after 22 minutes. So yeah, that was an incredible match, and all the other maps were extremely fast. We had Scale 7 minutes, Dubai 4 minutes, Little Creek 7 minutes, New York 4 minutes. Sure, I mean, there are for, like, good players that is kind of standard, I would say. But there's always this one map, or there's one case where you screw up, and it's we both have troubles. And so that match was really high quality, and that stood out to me. And it was such a memorable, and if you haven't watched that, I would... I mean, now it's really spoiled at all, but, like, that was a great watch. So that really stood my mind. And yeah, Mr. Mike also is, like, consistently a very good player. And yeah, he made it to round three, beating David, another very high quality player. It was just impressive to me as well. So stacked, really, really stacked first quarter. And yeah, it was a bit surprising to me, for sure, but couldn't have asked for a better outcome.
And Pujero advancing there, as I said before, that's his best tournament result, because everyone advancing to round four was already guaranteed a top six spot. And of course, we'll talk about how the later rounds went, because I think I managed to not say who the top three is, but I think Vivi will eventually, so I guess I keep it then just one moment more. But then I think on to quarter number two then, with Kaneta and Chris X3, the two first place finishers, and everyone's expecting them to play in round three, and they did. And the way we got there was Kaneta opened the KO stage by beating Papalevi 4-0. That was the first match of the knockout stage. First day, first afternoon, I think, in true Papalevi style, scheduled and played within 120 minutes. Then was Blythe versus Linux, which was a 4-0 result, and I think it was the match which ended during our episode 1 cast. So,
indeed, actually, you're right.
Yeah, it was Colorado and Haven, and we just couldn't wait until those long maps finished. But Blythe got the win in the end. No third map needed there. Third map was needed in Chris X3 versus Chaos, which was, I think, also a first or second day match, and for that reason, it might be already recapped for the second time, but I think it makes sense if we talk about all of them. That came down to a scale decider, and Chris being a contender for the championship, it might have been the first time then when he was scared and the fans were scared that, like, someone would not advance too far in the winner's bracket. But he did, and met Fusk in the end, who beat Mendo in two maps. It was Miami and Mumbai, and of course still a nice tournament by Agent Mendo, which didn't end here. Of course, double elimination means he still got a loser's bracket round going, but we got down to four players. Kaneta losing a map this time against Blythe was Sapienza, if I remember correctly, and then Mumbai is when, right, that was like a electrocution, which didn't work for Blythe, and Kaneta knew how to make a similar puddle more consistent, and he got the kill and win the match. Chris X3 swept, on the other hand. I think this was the first round two match, defeating Fusk. Both Danish men were in this group, or in this part of the bracket, but none could make it to round three, which was the highly anticipated Kaneta versus Chris matchup. They already played a final in a community event called Roulette Raceway in October. Chris won that one 8-4, and Kaneta fought back this time with the revenge, advanced to round four. It was also a 6-4 score. I think it didn't come down to too many photo finishes, the last map being Mumbai. I don't think it wasn't that close, but just a crazy back and forth match here.
Definitely, and I guess looking back at our predictions, nothing too surprising here, seeing how the three of us all predicted Chris and Kaneta to play in the round three match here. As I guess in this quadrant of the upper bracket, they clearly were the favorites. You could see a lot of sweeps in there, 3-4-0s in round one, another 4-0 in round two, and 2-4-2s. With only the round three match basically being a bit longer. Maybe not the most surprising result, but definitely was an interesting and an exciting part of the bracket as well. I think that's my takeaway from it.
I think it was really, as you said, guys, it was kind of expected. I think the round two match, Kaneta Blythe, was quite nice. Blythe fought really hard, but Kaneta did pull through. I mean, he's our grand finalist now, so. But that was quite close, and of course the round two matches were all kind of really exciting. The round two matches were all, I felt, were higher quality than the round one and two matches. I'm not sure if that's because it was best to six instead of best to four, because the best of four match, first to four matches were just over so quickly, and it was I think the round three and onward matches just felt so much more more deep and more high quality just because they were longer. But also you could say we talked about how there were upsets in the groups, like players that were expected to come first or second coming fourth. So the sorting system was first place against fourth. It went a bit. But still, I think that kind of worked out, seeing looking at the matches, and then in round three when they kind of clashed together more. But especially round three, that those produced super exciting matches. And of course, Kaneta Chris was really, really great rematch. Was super hyped to see, and yeah, Kaneta just pulling through by that tiny bit.
It was the top half, and set us up for Pijero versus Kekanet in round four, which we'll talk about after these next two quarters. The third one featuring Ducker and Danny Buta, the two group winners, but I think it really had three favorites, or two different ones, not exactly the group winners. So we thought that time, because Yanni was here as the second place finisher of Group C, he was either 1 or 2 points behind Kay Kaneta. So one, but the tie would have made
two more, yeah.
Yeah, so that's why you ended up here and played against the buff guy, I guess. We can start with that. Was two long, grueling maps, but I think it done fairly quickly still, and a sweep got you to round two. I guess I can go from bottom to top this time. Another member of the podcast, Currymaker, playing here and losing 4-0 to Danny Buta, but I think you can see his performance now that it's not an upset, nothing really surprising given how he has done lately. But of course, can sting for both of you guys, because you can see in round two that Danny got the four to win as well, which was just so memorable. I know I was admining that, so I can remember a lot of that. Dartmoor was the new world record for Danny, but I think you were even a few seconds earlier, Yanni. Just got a body found there.
Kinda. That was the case.
Kind of an unlucky body found with the office hall isolation. The Miami was much, much longer, and that Moses drowning was for Sierra, or there was a drowning for Sierra, and also the Moses disguise needed, making it really difficult. But eventually you tied it up, and then in Hokkaido, Danny just waiting at the exit for second Stalker consume poison. Just eternity, as Yanni just kept restarting and getting that really quick run, but just couldn't get it in time, and 48 seconds apart, and you guys finished, so there was a no final photo finish there. And that was Danny through to round three. The other half was a bit more straightforward. Dakar not dropping a map against Brainfixer. Papier Fiesta winning a New York decider against 420. And then Dakar dropping his first map of the tournament, actually. He had two ties in the group stage and a sweep against Brainfixer. It took until Venus Bracket round two for him to lose anything. Papier Fiesta taking the new Sapienza world record with that, but eventually falling short. And then Dakar also winning round three. That was 6-2. And I think what's worth remembering from there is, of course, both of them winning their own map picks, and then Dakar winning two photo finishes. So I think that's a interesting takeaway from that. But yeah, that's what I got for this quarter.
Gonna let someone else go first this time. Don't wanna just grab the word immediately each time here.
I mean, okay. If Punk has nothing to say, I'll just go again. So this quarter is kind of like it was apparently more stacked than I thought. So of course with Ducky and Ducker and Danny, we have two players who made it quite far in the tourney. Already facing off in round three, and that it was. I don't want to repeat myself, but that was a very close match, and it was incredible to watch, to be honest. And of course, I myself kind of underestimated Danny, to be honest. I knew he was a great speedrunner, but I never thought the match against him would be easy, but. He really humbled me. that was quite impressive, but also really good on my side. Anyway, a well-deserved win, and Dakadani, just great match to watch as well. But otherwise, Daka, of course, are really, really dominating. That's kind of as you know now. So I was not too much upset here, I would say. But yeah. An interesting Shinbeck part.
Yeah, also from my side, underestimating Danny, I think, in the early part of this tournament here was kind of a recurring theme, because I definitely did the same. So I also played against him and lost here, dropping down through the LB. But apart from that, definitely we can see Ducker staying dominant as he was in groups. Info from mentioned, dropping his first map here, or actually his first two maps. Facing off against Danny Buda, I think that's something that we can remember for the short future here. Ducker was also the prediction of all three of us to appear in that round three match. The other player would have been Yanini, according to us, but Danny proved us all wrong. Took that second round three spot for himself.
No one is ever going to underestimate Danny anymore in RR, that's for sure. No matter how these next matches go.
Definitely not.
With that, I think just go over to next and the final quarter of the winner's bracket. These are, of course, still round 1, 2, 3 matches we're talking about. And we need that final person to be guaranteed top 6 on the winner's side, and then Curry will tell us how treacherous the way to the same height is, because I think if you make it one round further in the winner's bracket, you can skip two rounds in the loser's bracket. So that's why it's so important to stay up there. Of course, we know that there are some players who can just keep winning all those matches in the loser's bracket. The final form is down there, but this is for a fact a bit easier to get to the final from up here. Final quarter it is, and fresh off his Group D win, Fruit 7 started to KO stage the 4-0 win over Mikulars. Then Joe Baby Grabber slapped Rommel, and fun fact, both him and Fruit won their round 1 match with Sapienza and then Berlin. No third map needed either, so they had similar strength, and I think like marginally Joe was the quicker in those maps, but we would have to look at the spins at that point to see who did better, and really what matters is that they both got the win and faced off each other. In the other half, we only had one match sadly, as T-North had to forfeit due to IR reasons. And so Meme advanced there and played Chromex, who won his round one. So the last map of his round one match was a 1 second win over Speedster in Whittleton Creek. And after plenty of restarts and PC versus console suite could have gone either way. Almost too close to call, but had to be called at this point, and Chrome got the win and faced Meme Junkie. Two more sweeps in round two, Throat advanced to round three. Just like Mr. Mike up there, plenty of others, I think. Two wins, 8 points, no map losses, so Throat is still in control. And Meme Junkie got the same 4-0 win against Chromex, who ended a 8-match winning streak in round 2. So it's impressive to remember. Chrome got all 7 wins in Group A, where I was as well. So I was looking for his streak to grow even further. But he went down to the loser's bracket and played me. That's spoilers, I just remembered that one. So that left us with Froth and Meme in round 3, and that was a 6-2 for Froth, and not sure if still the Santa Fortuna record, because I have an older text here, but Froth must have got, I think he got 2 records in this match. This was the one, his second and third map wins, so Santa Fortuna and Scale were both third records, and might have been a sweep, could have been. Meme was ahead either way, but a wrong disguise was Fruit's only mistake in this match, but a really convincing 6-2. And he was the one to face Ducker in round 4.
I mean, funnily enough, if that Mendoza wouldn't have happened, he wouldn't have gotten the Scale record, so like...
Happy little accidents.
Yes. kind of worked out that way. But yeah, to be honest, this part of the bracket is the only one that played out exactly as I would have predicted it. So like not a single upset here. Of course, I don't know what would happen, and like there was no for faith, of course. But this was kind of all matches as I expected. So yeah. Also, I mean, you often have the upset actually. So interesting to see. Something going exactly as expected, at least for me.
Yeah, I guess stuff going as expected. Definitely was the case for InfoFun here as well, as he predicted both Froth and Meme to face each other in that round 3 match. The forfeit was, quite unlucky, because first, of course, T-Not had to leave the tournament, which is not great anyways, but also I predicted him to face Froth in that round 3 match. Sadly didn't happen. But yeah, that's how things have gone. Punk definitely also predicted Froth. We all predicted Froth to be in that round 3. I mean, to be fair, with a man with Froth's experience and like the tournament he's won in the past and everything, I guess as soon as you see him, you can definitely almost always Ken put in the favorite position on him. So we all predicted him to take a part in that round three match. Chrome was Punk's second pick. Sadly, didn't happen either.
I suppose then it's round four then, and we talked about the four winners of those round three, but they had to push further because I think three impressive wins would get you a long way in a regular RR, but in the most stacked bracket of the year, it's only guaranteed you top six, and they were two wins away from the final. And as you can see, Kaneta was the one who got those two wins and is the first finalist here. But definitely some strange results here, a 7-3 and a 6-0. So let's dive into those quick. First, we have, Kaneta 6, Kaneta 7-3 Pajero. It wasn't a tie. It was a tie. It wasn't, the timer didn't run out. For the first time in our history,
true,
not even the photo finish could determine a winner, even by a single second. And maybe Ani will have something to say about that, as he was the admin of this historic moment. Then we came to Haven. Both of them had a couple of restarts early on, and PG found himself in the lead. But when he did a server lore for only Yudmila, which is something we really don't see often, but was a last resort for him, no pun intended, to get her like anywhere without an emetic item. He ran into an enforcer, had to lose that map, and Kaneta finished it off then. Santa Fortuna had a late Jorge body found for Pajero, and Kaneta was going for it and barely restarting. He was up 5-1 by then. Dartmoor saw Pajero come back with quite controversial consume poison kill. Not the spin was controversial, but the condition isn't very well liked in Dartmoor. So that was 5-3, but then in scale, Kaneta finished it off as Pajero peekabooed someone on the helipad, and he saw into the MOC room and saw a body, and then PG's lead was gone, and Kaneta just then dragged Zoe all the way up for a four kill, got the kill and exited, became the first semi-finalist. His opponent was Ducker in the match of all ages, probably the five-time champ versus the four-time champ, console versus PC. They played community events, they played exhibition matches, but this is their first RR encounter. And had a surprising 6-0, but every map had some unfortunate things happening throughout. First in Bangkok, Ducker barely got the early can cycle, because of course you know that there's the letter. You have to place at the reception, through just missed that, and time he lost from that was impossible to overcome. Then in Marrakesh, Throat was also leading, but I think there was a head turn which panicked, which resulted in a loud side KO, and Klaus panicked in the garage with the honeycomb, and eventually resulted in a target lockdown and a body found and a restart, and Tucker didn't have all of those and finished it off. And then Dubai came down to a photo finish in just 5 seconds, and the difference was that Throat smuggled his taser for electrocution, and Ducker started in it, and without that, or both doing the same thing, Throat was ahead and would have gotten that map. But it is a Ducker sweep this time, who in return also got swept by Kaneta. The only match I couldn't watch live from these matches, but I quickly recap that Miami Ducker had a crowd enforcer problems, and Kaneta just finished it off without that. In Mumbai, Ducker had a rip 3 minutes in, but was still able to finish just a minute behind Kaneta. So we could see that his threat was minutes quicker, but one more crucial restart. And then Santa Fortuna was the last map which Kaneta won, where it was more of a back and forth, but Jorge Fall, he just couldn't get him out of the shed and ripped there. And then, as usual, Kaneta just finishes his spins without many issues. And in his second tournament only, he will be playing for the World Championship title on Sunday.
Yeah, I think you've unpacked these matches really nicely, and those were the last three winner bracket matches, and they lived up to the hype so much, in my opinion. Yes, of course, two of them were sweeps, but the matches themselves were high quality. I mean, you don't expect that, but still, it was awesome to see. I don't really have anything to add, to be honest. I'll have to say, like, the Pedro-Canada match, right in the first map, we had that photo finish with 0 seconds apart, and it was funny because the day before I had made the match with 1 second apart, which it happens quite often now. It's quite impressive. And then next day we have Pedro-Canada with literally, I sat there for 10 to 15 minutes and tried to make sure that I don't call anything wrong, but it was actually not callable for any of these players, so it was just a dead tie. They played so equally that it was the same. So that was really cool to see, actually. I love to see that. And other than that, all matches went too close in the end. You could kind of see the winner. I mean, the sweeps as well, and Canada just came out on top more often besides Dartmoor. So, I'm just also impressed by the quality of play we've seen there. So, yeah, really great matches, worthy of the final winner bracket matches.
Yeah, what I also quickly want to add here, just by like looking at the names here, for example, Froat versus Ducker, that's a match. You tell me that is the match, I would believe you that it's just the grand finals already, because we have there are so many like so great legends playing here in these last three matches that like every match here could also just have been the grand finals, like no question asked, and I think that's really insane that we get to see even more of these kind of matches already, like, quote-unquote, a bit earlier in the tournament. And yeah, as you said, they were amazing to watch. Amazing. Just amazing matches in general. And yeah, I suppose, with that being said, we can already jump down as, of course, the tournament wasn't quite over for everyone who lost their first match in the upper bracket here, as this was a double elimination bracket, so everyone got a second chance here. Just gonna quickly go through them as well, starting with the upper half of the losers bracket here, and already in round one here we saw some very familiar players. For example, Inferfun on the show here as well, technically still reigning RRWC champion, already dropping down after his first match against David Red Sox. I Like Hitman, RR6 runner-up, and RR5 third-place finisher, also present after losing his first round one match against Crudy. Yanini, three-time RR champion, once on console, twice on PC. World Championship last year, runner-up. Also already down here in the second round after losing against Danny, and even more players with like lots of experience under their belt, like some random person who's been playing since RR1, Chromax, who had an incredible groups run, Joe the Baby Grabber and Papierfresse, two very promising rookies from previous tournaments, all already down here in the first two rounds of the losers bracket. So I guess you can definitely see that competitions were tough. Competition was tough. And I quickly also want to ask both Yanini and Inferfun a question here. Like, since, well, both of you are dropping down very early, how did you feel about that? Did the pressure of, well, a single loss, meaning the end of your tournament run, impact your performance, or did the well-known lower bracket buff kick in for you guys and you were like stronger than before or something?
You wanna go first?
You can go.
Okay. So, of course, when I lost Little Bracket the round 2 match, I was extremely disappointed in myself, of course. That was not necessary, and shouldn't have lost that. So, I said to myself, of course, Danny deserves the win. Nothing to take away from that, blah, blah, blah. But it was so sad, because like, progressing Loser's Bracket is so much harder. I don't think I played worse. I normally play better in Loser's Bracket. last RRWC I dropped down in round 1 and still made it to final, so that definitely worked. But personally, I perform better under pressure. Because in the Winner's Bracket, I always have that in the back of my mind. Sure, if I lose here, then okay, it's fine, I have a second chance. But if I have to win, then it's normally a good thing. Not when I'm like 4-0 down, then it's like, then it's normally just nerves make forcing mistakes. But in general, like a slight pressure, I think actually enhances me to try harder and to perform better. But I mean, I wasn't personally that satisfied with my performance, especially not in my like my last matches. But I mean, it did work. I won a few matches, but it was not something I'm really that proud of. So, but yeah, it was. But in general, I don't really mind dropping to Loser's Bracket. Just I would like dropping to Loser's Bracket like a bit later, like round 3 or 4. That would be fine.
Yeah, I mean,
then it's much easier.
Exactly.
But yeah.
As you said, quickly before I'm gonna give the word over to you and for fun, as we mentioned earlier, each win in the upper bracket after round 2, I think, gives you basically like 2 matches in the lower bracket if you were to drop down. So yeah, it really gives you the advantage if you drop down later. Yeah.
So I guess we really have like opposite thoughts about the loser bracket, or at least, anyway, I guess we agree on... like, that's good. Not good to be down there early on. And when I lost to David, I knew it was over because, like, roulette is just so random, or people are so close at this point anymore. So winning 9 matches to take the title was improbable to me. So at that point, I knew that it's. So the loss hurt, and then I realized that it's just going to be it, and then just try to have fun in these remaining matches, which. Yeah, I think it was 3 wins and then... Right, so the... Because, like, the 9 matches is just impossible to think of. The goal I set myself is to meet Jan in B5. So that's what I... And I guess that is something, like, more bite-sized or smaller, which you can work towards. That didn't work either, but at least that was manageable. And, yeah, something to play for. But yeah, at that point, just... What else can I say? It's just losing everyone is. I guess Yanni can make it work, and not even sure who else is like a big Loser's Bracket fan, but I don't. I'm not. I'm always a big fan of entering the final from the winner's bracket. I think it's everyone would love that. Just it's what I try to go for and push as hard as I can in winner's bracket as well.
Yeah, I guess one step at a time, as you mentioned, just like setting smaller goals for yourself might help here. Yeah. However, both of you made it through your first couple LB matches just fine. However, the competition did not die down the slightest. With 8 players leaving the tournament already after the first 2 rounds in this half of the bracket. Placing 25th and 17th based on the round they were dropping out. In the round 3, Infrafun played against the RR6 console runner-up I Like Hitman, and Yanini faced the great-looking rookie Agent Mando, who finished 2nd in his group. Both of your matches went to 5 maps. Yeah, like, both, however, 6-4 victories... for you guys, and I guess at that point, a lot of people were expecting a rematch of the RRWC Grand Finals from last year, where you two played each other. And people kind of expected the rematch of that happening in the LB round 5 here. The I guess only two opponents that were in your way were Mr. Mike, who was playing since RR1, and this the RR4 was RR4 runner-up, who dropped down against Pidgeotto and was now playing Yanini, a rematch of the RR4 finals, if I'm not entirely mistaken. And after 5 tense matches, Yanini came out on top, advancing to the LB round 5. And on the other side, Infrafron played Chris X3, a RR6 runner-up, or the RR6 runner-up, who dropped against great rookie K Kaneda. K Kaneda, just a great upcoming talent, basically. That match was a back and forth across all 5 maps. However, in the end, Chris came out on top, and ending Infrafront's tournament run here for a 9th place finish. Still very well, I think, considering there are 64 players, or 64 players entered this tournament. I guess 9th place still is a great accomplishment. After that, Chris, X3 and Yanini were set to play in the losers bracket round 5. Any last thoughts on the round 3 and 4 matches here before we move on to the other part of the LB?
I guess what I'm thinking of is looking at LB 1 and 2 and lots of 4s well. Here.
Yeah.
But just looking at this part of the bracket quickly.
Yes, sure.
Just reminds me how close they were. For myself personally, it was 2 photo finishes against Chrome, 1 almost photo finish from... Nah, 2 photo finish against Chrome, 1 against Random, and the other one was denied by Buddy Found, which no one could explain. So it just the first 2 rounds, being first to 4, were still so stressful because one single map was so much more significant, but I guess that early in the loser bracket, you just gotta suck it up and know that it's got a long way to go. And we're still close, no matter what the scores say in this part and the other part, which I can see already, but yeah, that's about it.
Yes, competition definitely was a lot tougher here compared to, for example, a regular Roulette Rivals tournament. I guess with that being said, we can have a look at the other half of the lower bracket. The upper half of the lower bracket wasn't the only one being stacked. This part of the LB featured great players in round 1 as well. Agent 420, an RR veteran who's played since RR1. Technically, T-Nord, who's another console veteran who's played placed top 3 multiple times throughout the tournaments, started as a first seed in this tournament. However, as we mentioned before, had to drop out to IRL reasons. Also in there, Speedster, another first seed, RR5 and RR2 console runner-up. And like lots of other great third seed players, Mikulers, Rommel, myself also in there, all already playing in the first round of the LB here, and also in the second round of the LB, even more second seed players dropping down. David Redstocks, who lost against Mr. Mike, Fusk, who lost against Chris X3. From these 8 players here, basically. 16 players, I can't count. Fusk, Blith, Crudy, I'm not sure if I can count or not anymore. Anyway, from those players, only Fusk, Blith, Blythe, whatever, Crudy and David Red Sox are advancing, and with this, with that advancement, the points required to win a round increased from 4 to 6, as we mentioned before, starting with LB round 3. And yeah, allowing for possibly 2 more maps, and I guess we kind of teased this a little bit in the past. Did you feel like the up in the match map count helped to create more tense matches, or just like enhance the competition as there was, quote unquote, more room for error from the participants, or just like more, yeah, more competition that way?
I mean, I think I already stated my opinion on this, but I do really think that it, like, as a player, of course, as a player, it's, I think it's difficult to call, because I personally like it, but I can see if someone is less experienced, like, has less experience in all maps, pretty much, because, like, it's such a broad map pool to choose from by RNG. So, I mean, it would be different, probably, if it would be a smaller pool, but... such a big insider pool, I think it's it kind of favors more experienced players, so it's difficult to call. But as viewer, I would definitely say that a bit longer matches are much better. Not because you get more, not only because you get more match mostly, but because like four or matches are so incredibly short and often. So, and it's also not really like it ups everything. It ups the excitement. It ups what can happen, and it's just great overall to watch. So yeah, I personally really like it.
What a first of six does is that we find the player who is better on the archaeology, for the most part, of course. It can always happen some unlikely things, but like in general, you need to win guaranteed one random map, and if you share or take each other's picks or something, then it can go up to 4 or 5 maps easily. While when the match is just 1st to 4, what you really just see most of the time is players practicing those 2 maps only. Mm-hmm. Especially if the decider is so big, it can be 14 maps, and then you just try to nail those 2 maps down and hope for the best. While, yeah, with the 1st to 6, you can be real challenged on many more maps.
Would you like to see that change with more maps per round being made to standard or quote-unquote standard RRs as well, or should it be an RRWC exclusive thing in your opinion?
Hard to say for myself.
It's easy to say for me. I would say it, like I like a lot of stuff that is not RRWC exclusive. I think that it can definitely stay that way. I'm totally fine with that. But I do think that best to six would make for better matches overall. So I would definitely love to see it in regular R as well.
Probably the change from 1st to 4 to 1st to 6 in several rounds is, like, there isn't many downsides of that, especially in the later rounds. So many things to do with the format, so many things to try out, and hope you get to do something with that. If this, then yeah. If something else, then I'm looking forward to it as well.
All right, and yeah, after the first 2 LB rounds in total, the player count shrunk down from 64 players starting the tournament off to 32 players making it into the knockout stage, and now 16 players only remaining. Were there any major surprises for you in terms of people that dropped out or people that, well, didn't drop out in the first 2 LB rounds?
I ran it through just quickly, looking at LB1, LB2.
I think it's kind of difficult to say. Like LB1, LB2, it's after LB2, half of the players that got to the KO stage are already out, right?
So yes, 16
players are out. That is a lot of players. But of course, you have to kind of see Yeah, which was like, you kind of have to expect that. If you say half the playing field drops will drop out, then you can kind of expect which players. And to be honest, I don't think really there were that many huge surprises to me. I think Johnny was kind of a surprise. But I mean, he had he forfeited, so like, we don't know what happened in the match. So actually, like, playing wise, I don't think there was a single surprise to me in LB 1-2.
I could say in short that no one that I expected to go really, really far lost his match in LB 1 or LB 2, and that still leaves with the forfeits not being mentioned, because it's a different case. But
yeah.
If you look at the matches itself, I don't see many upsets. I guess not even beyond that, at least 3 or 4.
Yes, that does make sense indeed. Well, after the first two rounds in this half of the lower bracket, Fusk and Wuth faced off in round 3, just like Crudy and David Red Sox. Blythe, I still don't know how to pronounce that name correctly, won 6-2 against Fusk, advancing to the round 4. Below him, David Red Sox took down Crudy in a close back and forth 6-4 match. Their next opponents were Meme Junkie, a third seed RR veteran, and Danny Buda, an upcoming RRWC rookie. Very, very surprising, I guess. Topped his group after being a first-time RR participant. Both these newly dropped players, Meme Junkie and Danny, won their matches as well. Meme taking down Blith 6-4, and Danny surprisingly sweeping David Red Sox 6-0, and both moving on to face each other in the LB round 5. And what were your thoughts at this point in the tournament about the success of Danny Buda, considering that he was a rookie at the point? Did you expect him to get this far, considering his performance in group, or when was like the point where you realized that he's actually here for to show up and to maybe take it all in the end?
Who are we talking about?
Danny Buda.
Oh, Danny. When he beat me, pretty much. But to be honest, he did have a very impressive group performance. I think that was nice to see. I did not expect that, to be honest here. And yes, the open stage performance just like continued where he left off on group stage. So I did expect him to make it very far, yes. But that was even like, I still never expected him to make it that far. Like, I don't want to sound mean at all. Like, I expect him to make like, sure, top 6 or something. But now he got so far. It's really incredible to see, and he played so great. I love to see him play, and I know we'll touch a bit more on him later as well. So, we can talk more about that, but. Very excited to see what next match brings.
I guess the round 2 match was the real eye opener against you. As scuffed as that was, I think the second and third maps indeed. But still, the fact that he beat you was something that everyone had to pay attention to. And that is a round 2 loss for him. No, it's around 3 loss for him, which put him in LB4.
Exactly.
And the win against David was not even a huge upset to me, because Donnie's second ever match was a 2-4 loss against him, and it was so obvious that his ceiling is much higher than what he showed in, I don't know, day 6 of the group stage. And he did surpass David's performance in this tournament. But yeah, by the time, the way he won against Meme and the score he got there, 6-0, at that point you just really had, this was like another small surprise to me, because Mimi is one of the consistent greats, which you don't see in grand finals, but you see in around top five contention. Hopefully you can still hear me, because I just lost connection to some stuff.
Yes, we can still hear you.
Okay, just I think it's breaking down around me. But then he's surpassing that level as well. Then you could know that he's in podium contention. And yeah, the rest of the matches are still, you are yet to show, but he didn't stop then. Just kept improving, so I want to say.
And I guess that pretty much sums up the first four rounds of the lower bracket here, and we can move on to the last part, basically, of the lower bracket. In LB round four, we had Chris X3 facing off against InfoFun. Oh, I already mentioned round four, I think. I already mentioned round four. We can already jump into round five. I just got it duplicated in my notes here. Nice. With the LB round five, there were only 8 players left alive in the tournament. Pidgeotto, K Canada, Ducker, and Froat7 in the upper bracket, and Chris X3, Yanini, Meme Junkie, and Danny Buda in the lower bracket. Danny Buda continued his run of sweeps, 6-0-ing Meme Junkie in LB round 5, and yeah, clearly showing that he is a serious threat to be feared. Yanini picked up another win against Chris X3 with history displaying a bit of a trend here, seeing how Yanini and Chris X3 have played 5 times over the course of previous tournaments, with Yanni winning every single match of that. In matchup of those, knocking Chris out of a tournament for the third time. So Chris X3 and Meme Junkie claimed a top 8 spot, Yanini and Danny moving on to at least a top 6 finish. LB round 6 held some surprises as well. On the one side, Danny Buda continued his 6-0 series, Pidgeotto being the next victim of that. And Froat7 versus Yanini on the other side, in the other LB round 6 match. And I stated this before, I feel, about another match, but the Froat7 versus Yanini matchup could have been one I would have considered to be happening in the grand finals of this tournament, and I'm sure I'm not the only one. On the one side, we have Froat7, founder of this community, first seed for RRWC, won four out of the six regular RRs on PC in the past. But guess who won the other two RR titles on PC that Froat didn't get? Well, it was Yanini, his opponent, first seed for RRWC as well, winning RR4 and RR5 on PC, RR3 on console, a runner-up for RR3 on PC and the World Championship last year. This was bound to be a banger match, but, well, what were your takes on the round 6 matches here?
It's an interesting day. I guess I started.
You go, please. No, you go.
These both happening right after each other, I think it was 2 days ago. We're really getting close to the present day. Just one more match to mention. So Donny's win was first, 8 p.m. He's a third straight sweep. And I think it's very rare that someone would win 9 maps in a row. Then we saw Tucker, of course, but like beyond that, in that group stage, doing that in loser bracket is just a really impressive feat, and Danny really seemed to raise his level match after match, and he's really picking the right time for that in the later stages of the LB. And I don't really remember the details of these matches. I just see the maps in front of me. I'm not sure if this time Pijero was ahead in either of them, or Danny was just quicker, because Danny is also very quick. So can just say that it's a very impressive win for him. And Pefrotiani, I remember a bit more, because, well, I guess both were a bit traumatic, seeing Pidgey and Daniani lose, two of my closest friends here, over the course of 2 hours. Santa Fortuna was first. Yanni got caught after shooting the cameras. Just early nerves, maybe. Say what happened there exactly. But then he fought back in Mumbai, his own map pick. So, of course, it was then tied. And then the two played Sapienza for, I think, what's the 17th time for both of them. Also against each other. Oh, Yanni had that... such an unlucky ragdoll physics with the lab technician, which was found, and Yanni basically ripping at the exit, which gave Frode the 4-2 lead. And the Littleton Creek, I know Yanni was complaining a bit about the RNG map choices, because it was revealed that Sapienza, Littleton and Paris were the three RNG picks. Littleton is not close to Yanni's heart, and Sapi at Paris being just Frode's living room. So yeah, unlucky maps and unlucky result. And Danny and Frode played in LB7.
Yeah, anything
indeed, but
yeah,
oh, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Not sure if you heard that. So yeah, but I mean, that can happen, like what, like an antibody can happen with such your side pool, right? But anyway, I think yeah, all those matches were really high quality though. I like personally in my match, of course, I made I made these few silly mistakes, but that was enough. So yeah, can't blame it. Like despite that, it was still such a high quality match. It was really nice in retrospective, and the Pidgey Dani match as well. To be honest, I was quite nervous about my match, so I don't really remember much about it either. To be it's But I do remember that Danny is just like just such a fast player, and that really showed against in his match against Frode as well. Like especially in FF, it was so impressive, because FF, of course, is the longest map, and I'm not sure if it would have made a difference, but Danny was so much quicker with that, for example, with that recoil injection right in the mansion. I think that it stood kind of out to me. That was really impressive, and that's something a lot of player would go for. But Danny is just like one of the fastest player, while also not ripping, of course. It's, I mean, that's always the secret of roulette, right? Like that it's not even a secret. It's just a recipe of roulette. So you have to be decently fast and not rip at all, or rarely and be really fast. But like just a mix of those two being really highly valued. And yeah, from all of these great players here, really a lot of them, it was stacked. Can't say it otherwise. Danny came out on top, and I think it was well deserved. He's a rookie, but like, played so impressive. Like, nothing else to say about it.
If I could say something.
Sure, go ahead.
back from the dead. Danny's run through the lower bracket. The whole of his lower bracket run, he's dropped one map in the course of four series, and he's got three of them are clean sweeps against Red Sox, Meme Junkie, and Pajero, and only that one drop was against Frody. That's all of his loser's bracket run, and the last match is left. That's basically the overview picture, because you guys were talking about individual matches, so I wanted to put in, like, you know, the outside perspective of how it looks. It's half the dream lower bracket run that Ain't For Fun needed to get to the final. Basically,
yeah.
He started with three sweeps and then just one drop map against Frody, almost another sweep. Yeah, he's looking good for it's a rematch versus Ducker from round three, which he already won. Oh, sorry, we lost. So this is his time to take a revenge, and the reward is really, really high. It's top two finish. Potential for the rookie to win the title.
Indeed. Yeah, as we were already mentioning, Nian Danny managed to take down the four-time RRWC champion Froat 7 as a rookie. And Froat finished his tournament run on fourth place, Danny securing at least top three, rematching against Ducker tomorrow. Last time they faced was in round three of this tournament, where Ducker kicked Danny to the lower bracket. Yeah, match happening tomorrow, 20 o'clock Central European time. So that's in...
It's really poetic because that's the only match he lost, and that's the exact match he gets a rematch to retry again for a final.
Indeed. Yeah, totally go over the match. They'll be playing Dubai first, which was Ducker's pick. Marrakesh second, Danny's pick. Definitely not playing Hokkaido or Berlin, as those were their bans. Yeah, last match before the grand finals. Nothing you want to miss, I think. And yeah, I guess that for now sums up the brackets pretty nicely. And I guess we do still have three players remaining in the tournament. K Kaneda already waiting in the grand finals for an opponent. And Ducker and Danny Bede are battling it out in the LB semifinals. Guess we can have a look at each of these players really quick, and their tournament run so far, starting with K Kaneda.
Right, so I was looking into K Kaneda, and going all the way back to the group drawings, he was picked as a sixth seed and placed on Group C with what I consider the group of death, with Yanini, Random, Meme, Flopper, Derek, Omar, and Ike. Even out of that, he placed first, topped Group C with 34 points with just one loss, 6-1-0. And that one map he dropped, is the only match he dropped in this tournament versus Flopper, 2-4. He lost Colorado and New York in that series, one Isle of Skill. So he's 11 out of 12 in Roulette Rivals World Championship. That one drop is the one in Group C. And he is currently on a 7-match win streak with a 5-map win streak. Also, he's played 39 maps. He's won 30 of them, and then one draw we talked about via photo finish. So he's got a lot of history and stats on his back, I would say. That's basically the overview of K Kaneda.
Yeah, I guess nicely summarized. K Kaneda forced definitely to be reckoned with. Top two secured this tournament so far.
Yes.
Can now just sit back, relax until Sunday, where the grand finals will happen, and can easily wait for his opponent, which is either going to be Danny Buda or Ducker. And I think we also have something to say about those, do we?
Can I say something about Kaneda?
Sure. Sorry, yes.
All good. So... I remember watching Kaneda enter Roulette Raceway 2. It was a community tournament before RRWC, up in for fun. And so he placed, I think he lost both of his matches in RR6, so the first yeah. tournament he entered. This is only his second tournament. I think we should definitely remember that. And already in Roulette Raceway 2, he impressed so much by his play. Because he was at the fastest, but he never ripped. He had two matches without a single rip. It was very impressive to see, and there was, like, in a game like Roulette, it was enough to beat a lot of players. And he lost eventually to the in the finals to Chris, as we mentioned earlier. But it was very nice to see, and I was excited to see him in RRWC. And now that we're here, till the start of RRWC, and even over the course of the tournament, I mean, this was a 7-week tournament, it's really long. But even over the course of that, I've seen him improve every match. After Race Way 2, I would say that's probably not enough to beat like a top 5 player, because it's just not fast enough. But then he remained that safe way, I guess, of not ripping, but somehow incorporated speed in as well. Which of course is the ideal thing to have in roulette. And so he had a great speed while also just never ripping. I think if I had to name one player who's just like would I'd say just rip the last, it's just Kaneda. And that to me is so impressive, and that improvement curve from R6 to here, he's in the final, in the second tournament. I think it's just outstanding. So yeah, just wanted to highlight that, and you now can gladly move on.
I think we can, unless anyone else has any more takes on K Kaneda here. Seems like everything is said that needs to be said. And I think next up in the list is Danny Buda now.
Yeah, not that I don't agree with Yanni, but he just said everything about him. And Sunday will be really interesting and really, really important for Kaneda. And potentially for Danny, one of the semi-finalists or LB finalists, or name it however you want, the second to last match of the tournament. The main storyline is that the last remaining rookie, and for I think a year now we've been talking about these super rookies. Last year's World Championship, if anyone remembers, Pixel Squid, who made it to quite deep in the then 16 player bracket in the KO stage. RR4, so of course plenty of rookies join. Chris X3 finished third in a very stacked PC bracket. And nothing was all that one. But Fenium got one place better and got its first grand final as well. RR5 was Georgi Kans and Joe Baby Grabber's first tournament. They got top 5 there. But, and then R6, I think it was just the veterans tourney. Still, no rookie has ever won their first tournament. We are just 2 matches away from that. Yeah, so Danny is the second Hungarian Roulette Rivals player. It's, for me, that's of course quite significant. Started in Group H as the 7th seed. So rookies, of course, are spread across as 8 seeds, but more than 8 joined. And Danny was quick enough to join, so he was in the 7th spot and got Group H as his, which was Speedster, David Red Sox, and then Goulet as the top 3 speeds. Top 3 seeds, and which turned out to be quite an open group. And he had some adventures along the way in the group stage. His first ever match was against another rookie, Shruik, and started in style with a sweep. Then came David Red Sox, his second ever match, which we mentioned was his first loss, his only loss in the group stage. He tied, so the score was 2-2, going into Haven, which may have never even played at that point, because it's just RNG picks this early in the tournament. May not even practice all 18 maps, so he lost that. He got a 4-2 win against Speedster, though, after 2 ties, though. I think that's worth mentioning. They were the first one to get Nolan Fall, and took a while to figure out. Got another sweep against Sappers, who then forfeited, so those 6 points didn't count. He led the group, and then without that 6 points, he dropped back down again. So he had to fight his way back to the top. But he did, with a 4-2 against Blythe, 6-0 against Doria. And going into his last match, he needed 4 points against Goulet to tie Blythe. And if that were the case, then the head-to-head would have been in favor of Danny. And Gule took Whittleton, so pressure was on Danny, but he took the other two maps and got 26 points, just as Blythe. And that head-to-head favored him and won the group. Then came, of course, the KO brackets, which we talk about basically every match so far, because first he knocked down Curry and then Yanni in round two. Then came the double photo finish loss against Ducker, and then put him to LB rounds four, when this really impressive, kind almost unprecedented LB run, just map-wise, of course, we've seen longer runs in the LB, but this dominant is it's not too often seen. That is 12 maps won and one lost in his last four matches to put him all the way to the LB semifinal. His most picked maps, of course, it would be all maps on one if it wasn't for the group stage where people can pick maps multiple times. Then he picked Whittleton Creek four times and Sapienza twice. So that's kind of the reason why those are his top map picks. After playing this many rounds, I think seven in the knockout stage, you can't really see much from the picks and bans. All three seasons have been picked and banned. Both Dartmoor and New York have been picked for him already. He is, I think, a fan of the shorter maps, but also been picking Colorado and Berlin, which is, I think, at this point to be expected from a top three player in the World Championship, just to be versed on all three seasons. And I guess I can wrap it up with but not too many numbers, too many people out. He has played 14 matches and won 12 of them. And his 86% win rate is tied for the second best ever, just behind Ducker. So that's what a successful tournament does to this successful tournament as well. If you break it down to every map, then he is more efficient than Ducker as well, and he's only behind a person named Tyson Futsko, who only lost one match in his career because he dropped out of the loser bracket, so we never get the stats for his second loss. So basically, yeah, Danny is already on top of these stats after, well, not even his first tournament ended. But of course, as a rookie, he didn't play on all 80 maps so far. He's on 16. Mumbai and Dubai are left to him. Dubai will change tomorrow because that was Ducker's pick and probably why Ducker picked that one. Everyone else, he has a 50% point rate. I guess it wouldn't be a win rate, it's just 40% in Haven because of one tie. But this doesn't really seem like a weak spot for him, and lots of 100% on R stats. And I can also see some like performance breakdown, season 1 and season 3 being his best so far, but also his season 2 is, I think, it's comparable to other top players. I guess just a notch bit weaker, or just a tiny bit weaker with Haven dragging it down probably, and a bit of pretty close. And to me, it seems like he's a bigger fan of the shorter and medium maps, but he's also winning on the big maps more often than not. So I kind of, as expected, you just can't really find anything on him. There's no easy picks or bans against him, and it should be a really fascinating semifinal tomorrow.
It will indeed. Any comments on Danny Buda's performance before I jump into Ducker's run so far?
I think Balint and earlier also Punk, they I can summarize everything that has to be said about Danny. So not really, but like, of course, as a rookie, getting this far is impressive, and his learning curve was also, like Netta, his learning curve was very nice to see. And, of course, he isn't like a new face in the community, as he's a kind of world speedrunner, but so that definitely helped, probably, with getting this far. But he is new to RR, and seeing him improve every match was really a joy to see. And he's definitely, like, we talk, Panetta is very safe player, never rips, and of course, like, all top players don't really rip often and are quite fast, but it's really, like, quite on the other side of the playstyle. Danny is very fast, rips sometimes, of course not often, otherwise he would be here, but he's really a fast player, so I think that if he would make it to the finals, I think it would be kind of a clash of playstyle, so that would be really interesting to see.
Yeah, really well summarized here, I would say. And yeah, I guess that leaves us with one player remaining to have a look at. And yeah, to the experienced RR player, Ducker is no unknown name, and Ducker is definitely a player to fear. The man whose name can't be put into Twitch predictions, right here in a position to win it all. I've heard people say that there is a big gap between other console players and Ducker, and the stats do in fact back that. Ducker is a 5-time RR champion, the player with the most titles, winning all RR console / Xbox tournaments except for RR3, which went to Yanini. Ducker is also the player with the longest winning spree, winning 23 matches in a row, not been losing since his last loss in RR5, went through RR6 undefeated, went through groups of this tournament undefeated, only tying 2 maps and barely missing out on a perfect record of 42 points. His winning spree eventually was ended by a loss against K Canada, which put him down into the LB semifinals now. With him placing 5th at last year's World Championship, Ducker has not had a tournament in the past where he didn't finish top 5, being top 3 confirmed this tournament as well, and by far currently the most experienced among the remaining players here. He started his tournament run in Group B, where, well, he aced that group basically, went 7-0, finishing where a lot of players would predict him from the start, at the very top of the group, however, tying Santa Fortuna against Bad Games and Haven Island against Cobalt. Not winning all maps per se, and arguably those are, however, the 2 longest maps. So I guess it's not too unusual to see a tie on them in a 30-minute time span. Starting in the KO stage, he came in guns blazing, winning 4-0 against Brainfixer, 4-2 against Papierfresse, 6-2 against his now opponent, Danny Buda, 6-0 against the legendary Throat 7, never dropping more than a single map in a match this tournament so far, only to then get a treat of his own medicine by losing 6-0 to K Canada in the winner's bracket semifinals. Now he's rematching with Danny Buda here, looking to repeat what he's done before and win the match to secure himself a spot in the grand finals, where he's looking to take revenge against K Canada. Definitely a man with experience playing the big matches, quote unquote, looking very solid so far. Yeah, I guess enough of me simping for Ducker. What are your opinions on his tournament run so far? And what are your takes on him and his performance of this tournament? Also, I guess a little bit his past.
The man can barely be stopped. I mean, he's already topped his last year's Roulette Rivals World Championship performance. He was 5th the last time. He's already 3rd at least this time. He has the 3rd highest number of matches played with 55, and the highest amount of win rate, which is 87.2%. He is, I think rock is too weak for him to describe. It must be some sort of a boulder in the roulette tournaments. It's if you go in his stat page, it's just bright green almost the whole thing. That's about as much as you can hype him up. It's like the group stages where he dropped 2 maps and missed out on perfect 42 points. This is like I don't know what kind of mindset he goes into, if he has an expectation for himself. But if he, it's also worth mentioning, lower bracket round, the final match that he's playing before the grand finals, if he gets there, is first to eight. It's a long one, kind of the same situation for the RR6 grand finals where he was playing first to eight and he was down 0-4. So he's on another one of those guys that actually thrives even if he's down. But because he's got so much experience, he doesn't feel the pressure of being down two maps where he needs to win four or five or six.
So hard to... I mean, such an interesting dilemma, because if that winner's bracket semifinal didn't exist, just Ducker was put down there for some reason, then I would really... I would really be surprised if Tucker didn't win his next two matches, losing 1-2 maps each. So I would say 8-2 and 10-4, and Tucker would be the top favorite to take this. I'm just still not sure what happened or why it happened or how severe that sweep was against Kaneta, and if that was something one off or. Of course, he had technical difficulties on the day with the controller, but I didn't. When I skimmed through the match, I didn't see anything directly impacting that. But he's still such a big question to me. If after 23 matches, having an off day like that, so will that happen again in the two most crucial matches of the tournament, or will he have another hot streak and basically dominate these two not so experienced but course very good players? I just can't tell yet. Neither can anyone else.
It's a good point. Sorry, I cut you off there.
Oh, please.
the thing I was saying, it's like after seeing so much green, that little red puts like a wrench into your plan. Do I root for him? Is he as good as he was, even though he's just his 23 match win or map, whatever it was, the streak was broken. It's a good point, but I'm betting that he will thrive because of a bit longer format. I don't know. It was a sweep, so that's what makes it even more difficult. If it was like a 6-4, you could still like argue for him. So I think InfoFund makes a good point how it's a bit uncertain what's going to happen for the final.
Yeah, I think I would agree. Maybe we'll talk more about like finals later and what we expect. But Hodaka, I mean, I don't think much more needs to be said. Of course, incredible player. We all seen him 1,000 times, and yeah, very well summarized. So I don't really have anything to add, and but that does leave some question marks, for sure.
Yeah, will he bounce back from that loss, or will it just get dragged down even further? That's going to be a question that's, in parts at least, going to be answered tomorrow. Again, tomorrow evening, 20:00 Central European Time, match between Ducker and Danny Buda. Don't miss it. Let's also, however, I guess, have a quick look at the match following that, which is, well, the grand finals on Sunday. And I guess because not much has been known so far, and I'm not sure if anything, like, if more is known at this point, but Punk, I'm going to ask you this directly. What is, or what's most likely going to be the format for the grand finals?
Most likely, one thing that's guaranteed is it's going to be first to 10. So, based off of that, all 18 maps will be discussed. What that means is, with picks and bans, you'll use up all of it, pretty much, except for the last one, because that will be the remaining one. The way it's going to work, again, first to 10 means you need at least 10 maps to be played. Potentially, if it goes like 9-9, that last match will be a decider. And I want to say that's not also like confirmed anywhere, but I want to say that probably is going to be an unlimited time decider because you have no more maps left after that.
Hawks Bay.
Yeah. Unless that happens. So the what we know, what I know is winner bracket, which is Kaneda, he will get the first picks, which is the picks on the pick and the picks on the ban. And then it will be back and forth until the last two maps, which will be the first pick will go to winner bracket, and then the one map will be left. You can technically say that's lower bracket's pick, but basically when there's two maps left, winner bracket will decide which one will be the penultimate map and which one will be the decider. So it'll be winner bracket picks, winner bracket bans, and then loser bracket picks, loser bracket bans, and then back and forth like that three times more, and then two maps left.
Right. Anything known about the cast yet, or how that's going to be organized, or is that still out in the open to be decided?
I think with Frody not being part of the finals as a player, probably all but guarantees that he will be hosting it as the main caster. That's all I know, and those are, and all of these are just basically based off of what happened before. So yeah, so Frody will be hosting first to 10 with winner bracket picking, first pick and ban.
Winner bracket definitely being in the advantage here. Thank you for that little insight. I guess more info will be shared in the Discord as it is known. At least I hope so, because I guess
The start time is also not known yet because we don't know who the other finalist is yet.
Yeah, of course, everything. Yeah, just three more days and then this entire tournament will be over. It's been long time coming, actually. I guess one last thing we can just quickly do, because we did it last time as well, and I actually kind of liked it, is do a short little prediction for both the LB semifinals here and the grand final, in the sense of, well, who will be winning that match. And if you're gonna, if you likely think it's gonna be like a sweep, if it's gonna be an 8-0 for the LB final, for example, or if it's gonna be much more balanced, like an 8-6 or something. Yeah. Anyone willing to go first, or shall I just go first with my predictions for the LB finals and the grand finals here?
Go ahead.
I'll just go then. That is fine. I think predicting is extremely hard. Not only because they are quite close together in my opinion, from like skill level. I mean, roulette matches in general, no matter how good you think a player is, it always depends on the day form. So I mean that is true for most competitions, but still, I think it is worthy to be said. Because if you just make one slight mistake, you can just lose the whole match. And that is something that can happen to everyone, to someone playing their first ever roulette where it's been, or player that has 8 turns of experience in 2 years. So with that being said, if I have to make a prediction, which, yeah, of course, that is the goal here.
It is.
We have first the semifinal of Ducker and Danny, and I so of course we've had Ducker, big unknown now, but I do think despite Danny showing some strong performance, I think it will be an extremely close match, and I think it will go actually 8-6 to Ducker, and then it will be of course in the final Kaneda versus Ducker, and that is a match. So I'm not quite sure what to expect. Of course, like, I have so much experience in watching Ducker and Kaneda and Danny Astor recently that it just makes it even harder. Like, they haven't faced off, so I think it's gonna be a 10-6 for Kaneda. I think Kaneda will win it all.
All right. Thank you for that one. Looking forward to maybe seeing that happen. Maybe not. Anyone else willing to go second, or shall I just throw my prediction out there?
Yeah, I can. I think I kind of have the direction going. Well, chances are I'm not going to cast or admin anything at this point, so I can throw all the bias onto this recap and towards you. I would really, really want Danny to win this, and I really hope he will. And for Ducker, like I like all three of them, just have to pick someone. Ducker has been untouchable since last year's World Cup. But when he did lose last year, he lost immediately in the loser bracket. So it wouldn't be that shocking to me if that happened again. Of course, it's a bit more crucial in the semifinal, but I'm still saying that Danny will win this 8-4 to advance to the final and meet Kaneta, and at that point might as well take the grand final as well. Trying to save last year's reputation by not expecting that close of a final, because 11-9, I hope that never will be tied. At least we'll be remembered for something with Yanni for last year.
That's not realistic. That will never happen again, I think.
I don't think so either. So, of course, Danny advancing and then winning it 10-4.
All right. That's noted down as well. Punk, you want me to go now, or you want to go throw it out first, or?
I guess I'll go. I really suck at predicting actual scores, because I got no clue. But I think I will go with 8-6 for Danny in the semifinals, and he'll face Kaneda. It's a good point the InfraFront brought up, where Ducker, when he dropped, and he's been sitting here for a little while now, when he lost to Kaneda. So there's not much we've seen from Ducker since then, and I want to say, like, Danny is, like, his streak and his momentum is hot enough that he'll carry it through to the final. The finals itself, though, is another... I want to say, so this is versus the consistency of Kaneda that Yanini mentioned and the speed of Danny. This is, I will say, 10-6 for Kaneda in the finals, and he takes it all.
All right, interesting. So we're going to have four different predictions here, which I actually kind of like, because I'm going to go ahead and agree with Yanni, basically predicted Ducker to win the LB semifinal. I guess Ducker losing his one, losing the upper bracket semifinal against Kaneda may raise some questions, some concerns, considering his performance. The stats show that Ducker is experienced on these longer matches, like this LB semifinal. This LB semifinal, I think, basically is a... Yeah, or is the length
RR6
of a...
RR6 finals.
Exactly. It's the length basically of a standard RR final. And I guess these longer matches can give Ducker the advantage here. Because, yes, we mentioned earlier, we've seen him be down like 0-4 in a grand final and still be able to take it all in the end. I would say that he's able to bounce back here from his loss against K Kaneda, win the LB semifinal, probably 8-4. And for the grand finals, it's going to be a rematch then of K Kaneda versus Ducker, in my prediction. And with the grand finals then being a 1-10, I think that might just enhance Ducker's strength and experience on longer matches. And so I'm going to predict that he's able to take it all and going to win the grand finals 10-6 for Ducker. And we would have our first, console RRWC winner.
Half a dozen titles for Ducker.
Indeed.
Would he be the... Of course, since we have the accolades or titles below our names for the RRCast, would he be the 2021 RRWC champion or...
the ultimate champion? RR champion.
We can go with that.
I don't know. What else is there for him to win? Buy him a PC I can win there too.
Yeah, now we only need him to like get a PC with his prize money and then dominate that as well.
Yeah, but then he's gonna be like, I already beat you PC people with my console. Why do I need a PC?
you come to my domain. Buy a console for me.
Yeah, it's that thing that meme shared way back. You're not locked in. Like, I'm not locked in here with you. You're locked in here with me.
Yes.
It's gonna be like, Ducker is no longer allowed to participate in normal RRs, but he's like the ultimate boss. Like, if you won the grand finals, you have to face Ducker, and like if you defeat him, then you're like, you're good.
Final boss.
Exactly. Nice. Yeah. I guess, however, with those predictions being done, we can wrap up this episode here of Roulette Recap 2. Has been an absolute blast over the past almost 2 hours now. Guess we are better in our time plan than last time. And yeah.
Guys are. I'm not. Just, you know, let me take a smaller bite, which I'm thankful for.
Anyway, that doesn't really matter anyways. I guess I can only repeat what I said previously as well. Do not miss the match tomorrow evening. Do not miss the grand finals on Sunday. Both great matches to look forward to and to watch. For more info on those, get onto the Discord for a 7 speedrunning community. Or check hit maps, as all the matches will also be scheduled and like announced there. You can also, for more info, follow @throat7sc, I think, on Twitter. Something, I think that's the handle. I don't have the handle off the top of my head. Also pumping out tweets about grand finals and what is going on currently. And yeah, I guess, lastly, I can only say thank you. Thank you to everyone who was watching, who's sticking with us up in this, well, very late hour here in Europe. Might just be a totally different time for you depending on where you are in the world. I hope you enjoyed it as much as we did. I think I can speak for all of us that we quite enjoyed it. Thank you absolutely.
I said absolutely sorry just
absolutely. Oh good. Thank you to the three of you, InfraFun, GK Punk and Yanini, for joining on this episode. I can almost guarantee it won't be the last time that the four of us are gonna sit here talk about Roulette in all its depth. I guess I can quickly like try and say the next episode most likely gonna be sometime after RRWC. Just having a bit of a look back on the tournament. Might just be a shorter episode with a bit of a look back, maybe a short look in the front, in the future of what's happening next in terms of Roulette and everything. Please, I guess, give us feedback on this. This is still just second episode. We're learning a lot still. Guess you can reach all of us via Discord, the server, DMs, whatever. You can, I don't know, tweet at me or us or something. You're gonna find ways to reach out to us to provide feedback if you want to, if there's anything we can improve, etc. Any last words from you to close this out?
Well, thanks. Happy to be a part of it. Thanks for hosting it.
Oh yeah. Absolutely, thanks for
indeed. Yeah, thanks for having me as a guest. I really appreciate it, and hope I could bring some some value at least to this great podcast. And yes, please do watch the last two matches, as Mo said already. Little Bracket finals already scheduled tomorrow 20 CET and finals on Sunday. Go watch on Hitmaps to see the date when it's confirmed.
Yeah, I also want to say thanks for hosting, Curry, and glad we could talk about this because I'm really excited for these next 3 days. It is the pinnacle of competitive Hitman, and yeah, you don't want to miss it for sure.
Definitely not. And yeah, I guess that being said, all I can say, thanks everyone for watching, and see you soon.